Frank's Red Hot is the perfect blend of flavor and heat. So you can use an entire bottle to make recipes like buffalo chicken dip or buffalo nachos. Or even things that don't start with buffalo. Frank's Red Hot. I put that shit on everything.
Hey, Craig.
Jeff.
Yeah.
We're going dancing.
Yes, we are.
And
you can't see it right now, but I'm dancing in my chair to our opening song.
How can you not?
I mean, I'm like Charlize Ledger Walker dancing in that Cammy Etheridge video. Or Charlize Ledger Dancer. For people who didn't get that joke, we're going to have to explain it to them.
Yeah. I still think that tweet should be doing better numbers, honestly.
Yeah, whatever. I do too. A good pun should never go unrecognized.
Charlie's appreciated it. That's all nice. All right. All right, all right. Welcome to Podcast Versus Everyone. I'm Craig Powers. This is episode 117. 17. It's right in front of me on the screen.
Yeah,
and with me as always, you've heard him. His name is Jeff Neusser.
Yeah, for the second time this week. Good Lord, it must be special because I'm too old to be doing two podcasts in a week.
Well, we had this one planned, and then
John did. And
the last one decided that he wanted to do a podcast with us, and we couldn't say no.
We're certainly not saying no to that.
I do want to introduce our guest. We have another guest, yeah. But I got to get our introduction song.
I was going to say, is she getting the proper introduction song?
Of course. Oh, I video plays after ad, of course. Hold on.
It's a high-quality production.
Sorry, guest.
She's clearly impressed right now.
Yeah, she's very impressed with what we're doing here. Video plays after ad. Oh, it's a she.
High production quality going on here.
All right.
Okay, are we ready?
And now... 6 foot one from, or is it two? No, 6 foot one from, University of Idaho, and works for some other school in Spokane. We won't talk about that. And a Pac-12 TV analyst, Alyssa Charlston.
Woo!
Let's go.
Yeah. How about
love
that?
Love it. Oh, I'm so fired.
Takes you back to your
up.
Playing days, doesn't it?
Yes. I was trying to think of some sort of joke to say, like, okay, my reaction plays after the ad. But, no, that was pretty incredible. That gets me fired up.
Welcome.
Thanks for having me on.
Well, yeah, thank you, Alyssa. So, for those who aren't familiar, Alyssa, we are official big fans of her here on the podcast. She's now a friend of the podcast because she has joined us. She
That's
is
right.
a Pac-12, she beginning, just at the end of last year became a TV analyst, in game and then on and sideline for the Pac-12 tournament. Just an excellent, analyst. I'm a big fan. We'll get into, her skills. But Alyssa, we know that, you wanted to talk the Cougs and that's why you came on. So, Jeff and I are obviously super excited right now. I know you're not a Coug, but I know you followed this team closely. How are you feeling about Cammy Etheridge's squad getting into the big dance?
Oh, I love to see it. Love to see it. I mean, when I was at KXLY as a sports anchor, I covered, you know, Cougar athletics for so long, and it's really hard not to have a little bit of a, you know, affinity for the Cougs and Coug fans and nothing like it, but it's really hard to not be a fan of this women's basketball team. I mean, if you watch them throughout the year, getting to see them in person for me in a year where many people don't, this team is just special. Like, that's what I've just been saying and realizing each time I get to watch them. And I kind of felt pretty strong that after they got that UW win at the end of the regular season, they'd be in, but to get that Utah win, I think was helpful at the Pac-12 tournament. And I'm really excited to see what they do in the dance because I already like, I mean, they've got some good dance moves already on Twitter, like you mentioned earlier. very impressive. So I was so pumped to see that.
Yeah, yeah, it was we were super pumped too. it's funny that as it turned out, they weren't maybe as close to the bubble as we thought. Like, you know, we were nervous. Craig would have been pacing around his house had he not had a blown out Achilles. Instead, he was sort of, kind of scooting around on his little scooter. But, but we were nervous. I was so nervous. I didn't even watch. I was playing video games because I was like, I don't think I can handle this if it takes an hour to get through. If they're not in like the first couple of regions, I'm going to start freaking out. It turned out, they were in the first one. Which, you know,
for
Craig
the second game announced. Yeah.
Yeah. Craig let me know that pretty quick. I was like, oh, well, that's fantastic. But yeah, like, I mean, to me, it certainly seemed like, the committee gave them a ton of credit for playing in an extremely, extremely difficult league. And were able to sort of overlook the record that looked fairly, but, you know, wasn't really propped up at all by a bunch of non-conference wins because of the situation. So I don't know, just like, were you surprised at all by how high they were seated?
I was a little bit surprised that they got to 9, because most of, like, Charlie Cream, you know, super expert man, had them at like 11, I think, before around, you know, like around that UW win. I can't remember if it was before or after, but to get a 9 seed, that was fantastic. And it totally echoed the respect to the Pac-12, because night in, night out, like, you're playing top 10 teams constantly, and to not get blown out by those teams. Like, the only tough games for Washington State was against Stanford, and almost everybody got blown out by Stanford. So, like, to be able to beat top 10 teams in and out, I think Cammy mentioned in one of our pregame interviews, like when we were talking to coaches before calling a game, they were the only team in the Pac-12 to play Stanford, Oregon, Oregon State, UCLA, and Arizona twice each.
Yeah.
Which is,
and they didn't play Cal at all.
That's right. And Cal was the worst team in the conference. Yeah. And UW. So that's just insane. And so I think, like, if anything, they're really emphasizing quality of opponents, and obviously going with that net ranking for the first time this year for the women's side.
Yeah, and I think the quality wins really helped them, because, you know, getting the Arizona and UCLA, obviously, but that Oregon State win, Oregon State made a nice charge at the end of the season, and they were in the top 40 of net by the end of the season. So the win at home and the win at the road become huge wins, and then that win at Colorado became huge by the end of the season. So they really had 5 really good wins out of, you know, And when you're only playing 23 games, like, to have that many quality wins, and like you said, getting that UW win was huge. Just beating Utah and UW at the end of the season to avoid it, they really didn't have any bad losses. Those are really the only teams that maybe could have been bad losses, and they avoided that. I think some people look at the USC game as maybe a bad loss, but USC, it was just one of those teams that was just – their talent is through the roof, but they just could never get it together. They didn't have any bad losses. They had 5 great wins, and we were just hoping that would be what would get them over and a 9 seed, which, of course, then you start looking at it, you're like, maybe I wanted a 10 seed instead, you know?
Right. This USF team, South Florida, is no joke.
Yeah. I think there was a very clear, top 4 teams this year, and so you're getting 4. I mean, it's better to get NC State, I think, if you win, than Stanford, and we're not assuming they beat South Florida, but just looking at the bracket, and getting Stanford or UConn or Baylor, or it's a Baylor the other one, they probably got the easiest of the ones, so maybe they were one of the stronger 9s even, so they might be even farther in than we thought, But let's talk about, so they're playing South Florida Sunday night, 6:30, on ESPN2, which is really cool. I would gather that, I don't know, maybe in the WNIT, they might have been on ESPN, but they have very rarely been on, you know, broadcast on ESPN. So that's really cool. There's going to be a lot more Cougs, a lot more people going to be able to see them. And so I know I talked to you a little bit before, and I know you've done some research on USF. So kind of you just said they're a tough team. So what about them? What about it makes them a tough team?
Yeah, well, I think the interesting thing is there's nobody on their roster above 6'3". So right off the bat, you look at some of their film and they are athletic. They move around really well. They also shoot the three like lights out. They really rely on it, which actually, as you guys know, entering the NCAA tournament is kind of like makes other teams salivate a little bit because you can't, if you live by the three, you also die by the three. I'm sure I'm the first person to say that, but they average like 7.6 a game around there. So you look at all their highlights and they're just killing it from three. And they have really, like, I guarantee their practices are like working on fast releases because they let go of the ball so fast and it's almost every single person on their team that can drain. So the good thing is Washington State plays like 99% man and South Florida kind of goes off against zones. So that's going to be good. And Washington State also puts the cool thing that I don't think June Doherty's teams really had much of was Washington State puts so much pressure on the wings and like defensively, they just get out and in you, they're really physical. And I think that's going to be helpful against South Florida because they've got really athletic finishers. If you let them get past you kind of like that first step, they're going to be able to explode past you and straight to the rim. So I think the fact that Washington State has gone against great athletes all season long is really going to help them. But South Florida, the thing is, like, the record is really impressive, yes, but their best win is against like Mississippi State, who was ranked sixth or seventh at the time, but they ended up being like 10-9. They're not making the tournament this year. So that's really their, I think, most impressive win. And then you don't have UConn in the American Athletic Conference anymore. So
yeah.
I think the scariest thing is just they've got athletes that can defend pretty well and get to the rim and finish strong. And they also can light it up from beyond the arc.
Yeah, it's funny. My brain immediately thought when they popped up on the screen against us and said American champion, my brain immediately thought like, wait, did they beat UConn?
Yeah.
Like, no, they didn't.
Right.
No way. No way. And then I was like, oh no, I had to look. I was like, they're in the Big East again. That's right.
Like, yeah.
But yeah, we're big on on the men's side, KenPom. There isn't a KenPom. But there is a site called Her Hoop Stats that I like to use. So they do some of the opponent adjusted stuff. So interesting. They definitely rely on the three. Overall, their offense, like when you adjust it for their opponents, like, obviously WSU played a much more difficult schedule. They're 251st in adjusted offensive efficiency. So average points per possession, 100 possessions adjusted for opponent. It's actually, but their defense, really impressive, 27th, averaging, adjusted to, like, if you were to play an average opponent, they give up just under 88 points a game per 100 possessions. So, and they play at a pretty decent pace, 71 possessions. So, and given that WSU has a pretty strong defense too, they're pretty high up there. As you said, they're much more attacking defense and causing turnovers, you know, with Crystal and Charlize are great at stealing the ball. And WSU is they're 136th in defense, but 46th in offense, which is interesting. You watch it, WSU, you kind of think they're defense, but it's probably because they get in a lot of grinder games. Pac-12 is just a grind, but they play at quite a slow pace. So slowing USF down might help a little bit too, right?
Yeah, big time. And I think, I don't know how turnover prone USF is all the time. I think they've got a pretty veteran squad, so that's going to help them in the tournament. And I know we've seen
they're
them
pretty,
in the tournament.
Pretty good, yeah. They're pretty low turnover rate, so they're like 58th in turnover rate. So they don't turn it over much. Yeah.
And you saw Washington State kind of take advantage of like the younger teams when they had those big turnover games, you know, against like Oregon State, and they turned that into like 31 points of offense. So that totally makes sense. I think what's going to be huge, huge is Bella Maricatete, like big time. Yeah. And Ula. I mean, Ula is always so solid and like the silent assassin defensively. Yeah. Like she totally leads the way. But can Bella keep her head in the game and stay disciplined? Because that's going to be
huge. Stay out of foul trouble.
Yeah. Because they outside of her, no one can match up, I don't think, as well with some of USF's bigs. So hopefully Bella gets her mind right.
I was going to say it's interesting that that you mentioned that they're not really big because their rebounding stats are what really jump off the page to me. Is I'm just kind of doing a stat scout here. Mm-hmm. They rate, you know, extremely high in both offensive and defensive rebounding percentage. And WSU has been kind of hit and miss in those ways. In fact, some games they've really kind of, especially gotten in trouble on the defensive glass, been unable to keep teams from second chance points. I know USC, you know, killed them with that. You know, the loss to Colorado toward the end of the season, that was a major issue. So it seems like this would be a really, really, really good game for Bella to not be in foul trouble and do what she does best.
Eminent Curvis is coming off the bench usually for Bella, and she's got the height. She's not quite as laterally quick, not quite as athletic, not quite as good of a rebounder. And if you're putting her out there against these quicker bigs, it's interesting. Bethy Manunga is their best rebounder. She's a very good rebounder, and she's only 6 foot, is, you know, the same height as Ula. But she's one of the better rebounders in the country, really. 28% defensive rebounding percentage and 14% offensive rebound percentage. Both those are just crazy high, way higher than anyone on WSU has. But again, we always have a, you know, with some of these stats, like when you have to kind of factor in the competition too, of course, like, you know, is she doing that against Stanford's front line, against UCLA's front line, you know?
Right.
But still, it shows that she has the ability. One player that jumps out to me statistically is Elisa Pinzon. Of course, I have no idea if I'm saying her name right or whatever. But
I think it is, yeah.
She actually uses, and then Elena Sinicki. So Lisa Pinzon's an efficient player, and Alina Shinecki is actually, she is actually even more a focal point of USF's offense than Charlize is of WSU's offense. So that tells you how much she like has the ball in her hands. And like you said, she likes to shoot threes. She shoots, almost 38% of her shots are three pointers. And she shoots them decently well, like 32%, but that's like about what Charlize shoots them as well, because they're taking a lot of tough shots. So she definitely is someone to keep an eye on. And that Manunga as well. They definitely have some players. Sydney Harvey, she uses a high rate as well, but she's still also pretty efficient. So, yeah, they have some players. Like, there's no doubt. Like, there's a reason they're an 8 seed. They were pretty high in the net. I think they're 24. So given that WSU, we're hoping that, Jeff, and I know you've talked about this, we're hoping that, you know, kind of this 2.5 weeks off is what especially the Ledger Walker sisters and Ula need, because they were playing some heavy, heavy minutes.
Yeah. Wait, were you talking to Jeff?
Yeah, I was.
Oh,
yeah.
You heard me? Oh,
yeah,
man.
I was. I even said your name, buddy.
I didn't know you were like telling me. I thought you were saying we had talked about this, and I'm like, yeah, we talked about it. So anyway, yeah, so that was kind of actually the direction I wanted to go too, because I'm like, we've talked enough about USF. Let's talk about our awesome players. Yeah. So one thing I noticed, USF, they will put people on the free throw line. That seems to be kind of their one kind of chink in the armor on defense. You know, they got an excellent 2-point defense, excellent 3-point defense, but they will put you on the line. And that seems like, to me, seems like an opening there for Charlize because, mm-hmm. You know, as Craig just mentioned, and as I so artfully screwed up, you know, we've discussed how her ability to put the ball on the floor and get to the rim, just like really, she just seemed to be suffering from some tired legs at the end of the season. She was just relied on so heavily for so long. And I know she's not a typical freshman because of her international experience and things like that. I mean, she can do more than what you would expect from a typical freshman, but it sure seemed like even she was maybe not immune, to playing, you know, 38 minutes plus however many overtime games we had and all that. The burst that was so good. I mean, there were so many times this year where, and I was kind of a late comer to the party, you know, they kind of showed me they were good. And then I went, oh, I probably should start watching them. And the thing that always kind of got me about Charlize was really her first step is so good. It's so quick and it's so efficient, really. Like, I don't know that she's the quickest player, but like she, you know, she just seems to move so smoothly and with such a compact burst. And I'm thinking, I'm hoping that, that some time off and some of this rest will rejuvenate, a little bit of what wore down as the season went on, you know, and maybe you could talk about like what it's like to play, you know, heavy minutes week after week after week and kind of how that feels at the end of a season for a player.
Yeah. No, that's such a good point because she has had heavy minutes and she does rely on like not exactly speed, but power. Like she's so efficient with her movement and like savvy decisions. Honestly, when I think about getting into the tournament, it's like you obviously, for us, we had to in the WAC, the old WAC when it was a little bit more legit than it is now. But your feet wear on you, like your feet just ache. All your body just it feels different than at the start of the season. And she has been the epicenter of the scouting report for every other team in the Pac-12. So one of the, like top two conferences in the nation. Every single team in that conference is eyeing in on Charlize Leger Walker every single game. And she's still able to put up, you know, 16 to 20 shots a game. And yes, not all of them are going in. Sometimes she was inefficient, but she's still putting up shots and making enough of a move to put up a legitimate shot. So like that wears on you over and over. You're going against every team's best defender, sometimes two, sometimes three, you know, getting in those gaps. So that totally wears on you. Physically and mentally too. I mean, that was a really frustrating Arizona game. You could see it on their faces. Mm-hmm. Like I was right there and they're in your face the whole game and they just don't, there's no relenting. And to see it on court level for the first time, like I did at the Pac-12 tournament, like I was further away and it's harder to see how much effort another team puts into the defensive game plan for Charlize, but seeing it in person, it was a whole nother level. It's just constant contact, always pulling on your jersey, always kind of putting an elbow in your rib. I mean, nonstop. So that is a really good point about having some of this time to like, you know, get in some ice baths and put your feet up. And obviously they'll be practicing, but they won't be practicing quite as intensely until they get, you know, closer to. And I mean, obviously once you get really close, you're not really doing much, but I think giving her some time to mentally and physically recoup is going to be huge.
Yeah, and interesting. I saw in their watch party that Ulo was wearing a boot. I have heard from coaches before that players, they'll just put players in boots mm-hmm. if they haven't even the slightest thing. Have you experienced that before?
I had some teammates that had to be in it, like in between things, and it was like more stress reactions that you're trying to play through, but they're not broken. So it's like, I mean, no podiatrist would recommend, you know, playing through a stress reaction, but if you're in the middle of the season, like all you care about is a trophy or all you care about is another win. So I actually didn't notice that in that until just now. I'm looking at it right now. Yeah, her right foot is in a boot. So I'm assuming the way she's celebrating, she's still going to be, good to go, but that totally has been something that, you know, I've seen teammates do and, you know, players in the Pac-12, you know, kind of taking as much care of themselves in between games as they can.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's, since you we're fortunate to see this team play in person this year. And I don't want to always talk about Charlize, but she's just such a superlative player that I can't avoid it. Like, so it's funny. Cammy Etheridge has talked about just how Charlize looks. Like, sometimes teams don't take her seriously because she just doesn't look like this, like, star athlete. Because she's got, you know, she's kind of like a stockier build, and she's, you know, she's not super tall. She doesn't look super quick. But what is it like seeing her in person? And do you get that first impression like that, or does it take not long for you to figure out that she can hoop and she's like an incredible player?
Yeah, very unassuming at the start for sure. Like, she's taller than I thought she was, honestly, because I'm about 6'1", like you guys mentioned in my sweet intro. I hadn't been, like, on the same level as her, and she was taller than I thought she was. So she's, like, I mean, I don't know what she's listed at, but I would put her at, like, 5'9", probably. And, yeah. Like, just, like, built, not even stocky, just, like, strong. And the thing that I think really benefits her is she's played international ball and she's played above her level for years. Yeah. So she's always played, you know, a few years above. And she does things that international players, like we had like 6 or 7 on Idaho in my junior and senior year. Wow. And they do things that you're just not used to because it's not how Americans play basketball. I had an Australian teammate that had a knack for like stealing the ball when you come down from a rebound, and she would come out of nowhere and she just took it from people at will. She would also do a ton of other things, and she was Australian, and I see so much of her in Charlize because she plays at her own pace. She's patient. No one speeds her up. Like, that's one thing when we were talking to other coaches before, you know, getting ready to play Washington State, they were like, yeah, they had such high praise for Charlize, first of all. But they were also like, she's unlike any athlete in the Pac-12 because you can't speed her up. You try to make her play faster and she really doesn't. Like, she is so disciplined in that way. You know, sometimes she won't take perfect great shots, but just her discipline, her mental, like, I'm gonna stop here, I'm gonna jump stop here, I'm gonna read over here, I'm gonna tunnel through and like throw this crazy pass, and her jumper, and just use her body when she's in the air too. Like, she'll go up for a lefty lay-in and use so much of her right arm and shoulder to, yeah, like, create separation at the rim. And, like, the scoot, that was the overtime winner against Arizona. Yeah. I mean, where she kind of went from right to left. And, it was a thing of beauty. But, yeah, I just, that savvy, you know, she knows how to play against older people, against guys, against anyone in the Pac-12 now.
Is there another player that sort of sticks out to you in this one for WSU that, you know, everybody's always looking for X factors, right? Like, who's the person who's gonna jump up and, you know, maybe, you know, give a key contribution, or somebody who's gonna need it. You know, Bella is obviously someone we've already talked about. Charlize is gonna need to carry the load, as she normally does. Who is someone else that you're like, yeah, this person could really maybe have a little bit of an outsized impact on this game? Is it someone like Joanna Titter, who, you know, is it an excellent 3-point shooter who could, you know, is going to get some opportunities here in this game? Is it, you know, Crystal Ledger Walker because she just has the ball in her hands so much? I mean, what do you kind of see as far as that goes?
It really depends on what USF tries to do, but Johanna has been absolutely lights out against Oregon State, and I think against UW. She hit like 5, or she hit 7 threes against UW. So
yeah, I think she had 2 or 3 points. And yeah.
Yeah. Just, and she goes off because the defense keys so much on Charlize, and they try to like make other players beat you. And I think Johanna has stepped up like twice in those situations, and that's going to be huge. But the thing is her game is a little bit limited to three. I know she can get to the rim, but she doesn't do it often. I think how Crystal Ledger Walker handles the ball is going to be the most important thing next to maybe Charlize and Bella. Like, her games where she's assisting like crazy is where they got back on track. And Cammy mentioned that, like, she had 11 assists against Utah in the regular season game. Like, that got them back on track because she was smart with the ball and she was just such a threat. Because, yes, she's a scoring threat, but when she's distributing and making good decisions as a senior, that's huge for them. That's so, so important. So I think the way that she plays is huge. And then one thing that we haven't talked about, and we didn't really even mention the Pac-12 tournament either, is Sherilyn Molina.
Right.
Craig has mentioned her.
Have you? Way to go.
Yeah.
In terms of how much her absence has meant.
Yeah, it's huge. And like, they didn't really speak much about it, you know, done with the season for personal reasons. I don't know. They haven't released anything since then, right?
Nope.
No.
Yeah. But losing her is like that. Akami was very clear about that. She's a spark plug. She's an energy player. She can get to the rim. She plays so fearlessly, and she is really not going to take really bad shots. You know, mm-hmm. there is always going to be players that try to get to the rim and try to do weird stuff with the ball at the end where you're just like, why, when you have Charlize and you have Crystal. But she didn't make those bad decisions, and she was a huge part of that Arizona win. So that's a huge bummer. And honestly, they do look like a very different team without her.
Yeah. She's basically your sixth, you know, your first person off the bench. And, her last game was that UCLA win, and they went on a 4-game losing streak. I honestly believe they would have won at least two of those. We might be talking about a 6 seed, you know, 6 or 7 seed right now, instead of a 9 seed. She was huge, huge against the win at Oregon State. She rescued them in overtime and at the end of regulation with some huge threes. She wasn't a 3-point shooter last year. She added that to her game. She just incredible on-ball defender, very pesky. Like you said, she gets to the rim. We don't have that now. Like, there's outside of Charlize, like, you know, Crystal doesn't really drive to the rim. She's more of a drive to the, you know, free throw line. And if she's mm-hmm. driving to the rim, she's dribbling out, you know, like she's taking it out, or she's passing out. Right. So that's just not a skill. Like, Sherilyn had just a skill set that we, and she, you know, she wasn't a huge minutes player, but the minutes that she played, she was very efficient, very effective, and was a unique skill set. And yeah, it bums me out that, you know, I hope she's okay. I hope everything's okay with her. We're clearly not the same team without her. But I'm hoping that, you know, these games against UW and Utah, and they've just kind of figured some things out, and the rest, especially we talk about for Charlize, but Crystal, her shot just left her at the end of the season, and she was playing heavy, heavy minutes, almost as heavy minutes as her sister. So I'm hoping that she's such a streaky shooter. She's one of those players that if she gets hot in this game, like she could score 25. She could hit 6 threes, you know, because she has the ball so much. So I'm just hoping that, you know, the rest and I'm hoping some of our, you know, we got, you know, I say we, cause we're Cougs, but, they had trouble against some bigger teams sometimes. Obviously it's not going to be a bigger team. This is actually their height, especially with Bella, is going to be an advantage. I'm really hoping for some buckets down low from Bella, and hopefully she can like clog the paint and just be tall and grab rebounds and block shots. And then, you know, threes from Johanna, threes from Crystal, threes from Grace, threes, you know, if Michaela Jones gets in there, you know, whatever. Like, it's just, you played in NCAA tournament games. And you were one of the better players on your team. You're one of the best players in the WAC. So you seem, just from your career, you must have been one of those competitive players that like those big moments. And Charlize seems like one of those big moments. Do you think is there something about a player like Charlize that can rise to these moments and kind of elevate her game?
I definitely think so. She's showed she doesn't get too high or too low. And that's so rare as a freshman. Like, she definitely has had some tough games, but she bounces back really fast. And she didn't have a major slump where she was scoring 6 points and then 2 points and then 4 points. You know, like, it was always, okay, maybe down to like 13 and then back up. And
unless you're playing Stanford.
True.
But they do that to everybody. So yeah. No shame there.
Yeah, that's one where you just kind of
write those off. Yeah, those are okay.
Yeah, that's a team that's like probably going to win the national championship. It's going to be really fun to watch. But
by the way, side note, time out real quick. Mm-hmm. How did they ever lose?
Stanford?
Yeah.
How did Stanford ever lose a game ever?
Okay, well, this year they were on the. I mean, they lost their two games when they were on the road for 2 months. The girl from Colorado.
That's no excuse. That's no excuse.
Tara Vanderveer makes no excuses.
You got to be tough. But for real, they like watching them play. It really reminds you of those, you know, ridiculous UConn teams of the last, you know, decade that just so much talent, so much athleticism, so much height. You're just like, they are playing a different game, it seems like, than everybody else.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, the one games where they lost but they were close ones, like later on, they made a big change in their lineup, bringing Cameron Brink, the really tall blonde. She's like 6'4" and just like a blocking machine. And putting her in more and trusting her more totally changed their defense, because their defense was good early on. But like watching Stanford in December was so different than watching Stanford mid-February or early February even. Like they became a freaking powerhouse. And it's just so refreshing to, I know it's Stanford. It's not like some new team on the scene to win a national championship, but for someone to continue to challenge UConn and South Carolina. Now I'm just pumped that we have a team from the West Coast that is representing the best coast.
Nice.
So one quick thing that I want to see if you can do for our listeners. So probably a lot of our listeners haven't watched them very much this year. Virtually all the games either on Pac-12 Network or even just, you know, streaming on the WSU website. So from a, you know, from an analyst perspective, you know, when a newbie fan is watching our offense, you know, what's something that they can kind of, you know, maybe key in on or keep an eye on, an action or something like that that WSU likes to do in order to get the shot they want to get?
Well, that's a great question. No surprise. Start with just watching Charlie Fudger Walker. The way that she moves is just different from other players. And it's not just other freshmen. The way that she sees things, her eyes are always up and she's not worried about like double teams coming to her. I would say their offense has changed a lot. And that was one thing that like they were trying to work on getting more consistent, because they don't run a ton of set stuff. They kind of play free. And when they go against zone, they move really well inside and outside. I would say like against a zone, if USF tries to go zone on them, which if they do, it's probably going to be like box and one on Charlie Fletcher Walker. But they, as of late, their posts really started cutting well, like into the key. Emma Nan Curvis jumps out. Like she's a great passer from inside the post to out. Mm-hmm. She's so good at like reading the floor and being patient. Bella down low, her post moves are pretty great. They're getting, they were not suspect by any means, but you just kind of like worry, like, where is she going with this early on in the season? And that's something like other Pac-12 coaches said too, like from last year to this year, she has made easily the biggest improvement out of any post in the conference, just offensively. So I think just watching her, but truly here it is. Now that I've spent 2 minutes talking about it, I've decided it's definitely Charlize and Crystal reading each other, and other players, because early on they would throw these passes that I say like tunneling through people and like over the tops of defense, like hook shot over, like you'll be driving to like the right elbow, throw a hook shot pass, like style over the top to like left corner and hit like Johanna Tadar for a three. So, the way that they pass is just something you don't see elsewhere in women's basketball. I mean, really, no one tries the risky passes that they throw, and they're darts. They're not like, oh, maybe we'll see if this works. It's like, get ready, otherwise you're probably going to get a concussion. And that was something early on that like their teammates didn't really recognize, and they got the hang of it really fast, because you saw the improvement from game to game, just Charlize and Crystal passing to each other and passing to other teammates. It's just, I haven't seen players pass like this in a really long time, and even on the best teams.
And then how about on the other end of the floor, defensively, what are they trying to take away from their opponents?
They are so physical out on your guards. So I asked Cammy a bunch, like I might have asked her like 3 or 4 times, like, how are you beating these teams that are way bigger than you? Like Oregon State has 2 girls on their squad listed at 6'9", like 6'9", 6'7", 6'4". Oregon, very similar. Stanford, we know, is giant. Like, how are you beating these teams that completely outsize you? And she said, we're really physical with our guards on defense. So, like, we're going to press up into you, and she lets them be pretty free. She gives them the freedom to gamble if they want to or lay off if they want to. So she lets them kind of read their own instinct. And she's just recruited players that play by instinct, whether they're international or not. Defensively, you just see them. It's not even like a harassing like Arizona was on defense. It's just like a frustrating because you have nowhere to go. And their hands are everywhere, like all over, up, down. And then, you know, someone's going to jump into a passing lane. And that, again, Craig, is where we miss Sherilyn Molina. She was so good about reading passes and jumping into those passing lanes. But that is really their defense, the key to their man defense, because down low, they're just disciplined, I'd say. But they didn't let the ball go in against those big, huge teams that could have killed them down low. And that was probably their biggest reason why.
Yeah, they really had some incredible, like, defensive stretches. Like, there was, I think it was against, they made a big comeback at UCLA and in the fourth quarter to send it into overtime. And UCLA didn't score for, I think, the first 8.5 minutes of the fourth quarter. And yeah, it was just forcing tough shots inside. And they can just, they can lock down defensively for like 10 minutes in a row. And that always keep, when the shots aren't falling, which towards the end of the season, have more, it kept them in games quite often. And so that encourages me for this game. And yeah, I love what you said about just how they harass up top just to kind of make it difficult to get into the offense even at all. And yeah, so I guess we'll wrap up the game preview here. If you break it down to like one or two, one or two pieces that WSU needs to do to win, what do you see here against USF?
Limit the threes, at least be out on them, run them off the line, and then have some help defense behind, but you cannot let them get going from three. And the NCAA tournament in general, the stage will also play some defense in that, like limiting and making it just tougher to hit shots. So that is huge. And then offensively, they've got to be able to work the ball around, like in and out. It can't just get stuck in one player's hands because USF will feast on that. So ball has to move around. Charlize will get the looks that she's going to get by ball movement and then seeing open space, you know, and screen setting. I think, those are going to be the two biggest things. If Bella or if Crystal can be a threat in addition to Charlize, you've got to have somebody else step up and have provide depth throughout the game, you know, be able to fill it up and take some of the pressure off Charlize.
Yeah, and there was one more thing I wanted to ask you, and it has nothing to do with the game, but you kind of had a similar situation in school where when you were at Idaho, you were on a team that broke a 28-year, I think it was 28-year tournament drought. And then obviously WSU just broke a 30-year tournament drought. First of all, what did it mean for you doing that? Like, was that something that was on your mind when you were obviously at Idaho, you won the WAC tournament to get into the tournament. So it was more of like winning a game to get there rather than, waiting for a selection committee. But did your coach ever say that to you or when you were committing to Idaho, did you know that, you know, this is a program that has not been to the tournament in a long time and we want to take them there. So were those things that you were thinking about? And then when it happened, was it something that you thought about as well?
Honestly, when I committed, had no idea. And I think coaches try to like hide that as much as they can. And I almost guarantee you nobody on Wazoo knows because honestly, they're mostly from different countries. A majority of them are from different countries. So it's like they come in and who cares about that. But it does matter. And when I found out about it, I think I was a sophomore, and we didn't go until my junior year. Mm-hmm. And I was like, it's almost something you don't want to talk about if you're right. a player. Like, you don't want to talk about the history of your school not being able to make it to the NCAA tournament. And it's something that's definitely gratifying, because now that I think about it, it's way cooler to say. And like, you think about the generations that went before you, the players, the really good players that were before you, and they still didn't get to go to the NCAA tournament. But it is a big reason why I chose Idaho, because I was, you know, I had some Pac-12 interest. I had some Big 12 interest, coaching wise, but in the Pac-12 at that time, unless you were a top three team, you weren't going to the NCAA tournament. And right. at Washington State, like it would be fun to go there, but the goal is to dance at the end of the season. And Idaho, for sure, that opportunity was there. You had to win the conference tournament, but it was, I totally believed it was wide open with the people we brought in my recruiting class and then beyond. So it's so special to think about now and to see, you know, 30 years, it's a sign of change. And I think it's a really good change for Washington State. A lot of people, you know, whatever she decides to do, a lot of people say that Cammy Etheridge is perfect for Pullman and loves Pullman mm-hmm. because she was in, you know, Kansas State for so, so long. And that's not a big metropolis. She's ideal and thrives in kind of like smaller communities and gets players with chips on their shoulder, and they immediately respect her. So I think huge sign of change. And just that's the biggest thing. It's like, okay, we're only going up from here. And the leaders on that team right now will hopefully continue that, you know, and like hold that standard. It just, the biggest thing is it sets a new standard.
Absolutely. That's a great bit of insight. Because not a lot of players have done something like that. And obviously with Charlize on board, we're hoping it's at the very least four in a row to come in.
Right.
We're hoping we're just getting started.
And I will say, like, you talked about Bell's improvement. Players like that. It obviously Charlize is a prototype player, but we got to remember they lost two very good players in Bobby and Chanel Molina out from last year's team. So, mm-hmm. Because I didn't know anything about Charlize, I didn't think they were going to be any good. Like, you know, man, they won four games last year.
Well, you weren't alone, dude. Like, they were picked last in the conference. Like, the coaches didn't know either.
The coaches had no clue. Yeah.
And
that's so true.
Yeah, bringing in Crystal and bringing in Charlize, and it's amazing how much players matter in basketball. Like it's truly more than any other sport. Like if you get a couple players in there, your program changes. And Charlize is a program changer for sure. We of course we brought you on because. And I hope that our listeners have already realized this through what you said, because we're just so impressed with your work as a TV analyst on Pac-12 Network. Actually, I'll let Jeff take over because he's the one that kind of blew you up on Twitter a little bit.
I didn't even know what I was doing, man. Yeah.
That was awesome.
Well, I just like I turned on this game and I'm going to be honest, like I like 100% this is going to be, you know, it's going to probably sound super terrible, but like I didn't really know much about you, and I was like, I just turned on this game and I'm like, this is really good. Like this is, you know, and you know, I know you're, you know, not going to, you know, speak to all this necessarily, but Craig and I often complain about the broadcasters that we are sort of saddled with as we watch these games, and I think a lot of it is a function of there's just so many games, right? Like mm-hmm. everything's on TV, which means they need lots and lots and lots of broadcasters, and some are okay and some are really not okay, and sort of my threshold for a broadcaster, for an analyst in particular, is okay, so you better either be really entertaining, or you know, be insightful. Like, let me know, like, tell me, and not that basketball is super complicated. And I mean, like, you know, most of the time the casual fan can kind of see more or less what's going on. So it's like, look, if you can give me some nuggets, if you can, you know, point out something that maybe is happening away from the ball that maybe I'm not noticing because, you know, I'm a fan and I watch the ball, right? Like, you know, if an analyst can do that for me, then I'm like, yeah, you know, you're now adding to my experience of watching the game. It's not, you know, I don't need to feel like I'm going to class, but mm-hmm. I should also feel like, you know, that the analyst is there for a reason, like, and not just to fill yeah. airtime. And, you know, again, the game, and I don't even remember which game it was, but I just remember I turned it on and I was like, this is really good. Who is that? You know, and like, and Craig was like, that's Alyssa Charlston. She did it. And I'm like, oh, that's really good. So I'm like looking up on Twitter and I'm like, you know, and then of course the tweet was just like, and I feel bad because I kind of said some not very complimentary things about other people who have called WSU games. So I felt kind of bad about that. But mostly I'm just like, you know, by comparison, you were like really good and you were doing, you know, that thing that I was saying, which is just sort of like, you know, not feeling compelled to fill every second of dead air time with nonsense. And then just, you know, pointing out some nuggets here and there that make me a little bit of a smarter fan, a little bit of a smarter watcher. I guess all of that praise is sort of a way, kind of a gateway into, you know, what do you see your job as when, I mean, do you sort of see it the same way I see it? Do you try and bring something else? Like, how are you trying to approach a broadcast when you do? Cause you, like, I mean it, you are really good.
Thank you so much. I so appreciate that. First of all, I'm really surprised it was the first time you've heard me because I'm a really big deal. I'm all over the place. Famous.
Well, so. In fairness, I probably have heard you before and I probably no. didn't realize it. And so I you know, I'm slow. It's okay. I'm slow. I'll own that.
No, totally, totally fine. Like, my parents are my biggest fans and that's totally fine with me. This is the first time I got to do Pac-12 games was this season and they were only home games. So it's such a learning process, but I go in with definitely like a player mentality and like studying scouting plan. Like I try to reach out to more people than just the coaches that I'm about to, you know, call a game for. I try to reach out to grad assistants or the weird thing is basketball is such a small world that I know at least one person on every single Pac-12 coaching staff. And I didn't realize that until I started doing this. I was like, oh my gosh, she played at Montana. I played against her. He recruited me, like, you know, these, and that kind of happened at the Pac-12 tournament too. Like, they were like, wow, Alyssa recruited you a long time ago. I was like, well, I wasn't going to bring it up because, it's not cool for me to remember that and then be embarrassed and not have the coach. But, I think like scouting and watching games, trying to trust my instinct. Cause initially, like you listen to, Jay Billis or you listen to Bill Raftery or whoever, and you almost want to mimic them at first and try to write down things that they say and mm-hmm. all that stuff. But at the same time, it's like, I'm not going to remember, you know, these really cool pieces of insight during the game. You really don't. Your brain is like all over the place. And sometimes you like black out. You're like, where am I? And what am I supposed to say here? But I think just trusting your own instinct. And I was a very cerebral player. So that helps, you know, I cared when coaches were bringing analytics to me and stuff like, this is what is happening when you're going to your right. And this is what's happening when people give you your left, you know, more often. And that stuff was super helpful for me. And the turnover offensive rebound stuff that we were talking back and forth on, like yeah. we had a rebounding bank where we would have a certain amount. If you, it was kind of like a surplus and minus. So if you gave up 15 against one team and then you only gave up 7, I think it was like anywhere above 10 or under 10. And like we had to run lines for it at the mm-hmm. end of a series or something like that, like, you know, a weekend game series. So that was an emphasis brought by strictly by John Newley. So that's something I thought about and he would bring it up in timeouts. Like we are getting absolutely slaughtered on the offensive rebounds, but continue to take care of the ball. Like he would, it was just those two kind of things went hand in hand. And, or if we were turning it over like crazy, he would pull me aside or my post coach would tell me, pull me aside and be like, look, so-and-so is having a really tough time handling the pressure of this guard. You need to attack the glass, get on the glass. And it was like, okay, creating those opportunities. So I think playing and really absorbing things as a player helps me with my analysis and like learning from play-by-play guys as much as I can. And I'm really excited for continuing this and like continuing to learn, because I have so much to improve. I have so many things I want to get better at. But yeah, I loved your tweet, and I loved, I couldn't agree with, you know, yeah, like any of the broadcaster stuff. Yeah. But I so appreciated the shout out. It meant a lot.
What's super clear, and you mentioned this, is the preparation. Because it is so, so clear when people don't prepare. And we have had, oh my gosh, like, you know, this year.
Say a certain UW alum.
Colleague of yours on the Pac-12 Network. So we won't air that one out too bad, but like for real, it's really frustrating when you feel like, okay, you know, this person has to, you know, I mean, this is their job. Like, and I, you know, I understand it's a part-time job. It's a contract job. I mean, I get that, but it's also like, you're going to be on TV for 2 hours talking about this team. Yeah. And it's really, I mean, and it's not limited to Pac-12 Network. I mean, we get that on ESPN when we're on ESPN and they put, you know, someone like Adrian Branch on or someone like Corey Williams on. And I'm like, have you watched our team play at all? Like, right. You know, I'm just like, I don't get it. It's really obvious that you do your homework, and that you're ready to go, and that you have a keen sense of, you know, Craig and I spend a lot of time, you know, doing analytics, breaking down analytics, looking at, you know, stats that might give some insight into why teams are able to be successful. And, you know, like the offensive rebounding turnover thing, that was one that really kind of struck a chord, because so the men's team this year, for us, you know, like that was, they were not a great shooting team. And yet they were able to sort of hang around some games and able to, you know, pull off a couple upsets. Like they were able to do some things where it was like, I'm watching these broadcasts and they're saying, you know, again, I don't even know how WSU's in this game. And I'm like, I do, you know, it's like, they have, you know, 12 more shots than the other team because they're killing it on the offensive glass. Like if you shoot 10% less on your shots, but you have 10 more attempts, you're probably going to be okay. You know, and, or for this game, they, you know, there was, I think the USC game, you know, their turnovers were actually down for once. Like it was, you know, it's not that tough necessarily, to understand how points are produced, and it's not just making shots. And when a broadcaster sort of has a sense of that and understands, like, hey, you know, it's why the four factors exist, right? It's like, you know, it's not just shooting, it's turnovers, it's offensive rebounding, it's free throw attempts. Like when you put those four things together, it's going to be some combination of those four things, and being able to kind of put your finger on, you know, which of those four things is kind of moving the needle, to me is an important and valuable piece of insight. And I really appreciated that you had like this sense of like, hey, there's these different ways you can create points, you know, and not everybody, even former players, seem to get that. So I'm not sure if there's a question in there somewhere, but you know, for whatever it's worth, that's definitely something that I noticed and was like, yeah, that's unusual. And I don't know if you realize that it's unusual, but it's unusual given the amount of basketball that I watch. It's pretty cool. So good job on that too, I guess.
Well, I do have a question. Thank you. You talked about what you did to prepare. And, one thing I gather is that, you know, what we see about these broadcasters when we talk about, have you watched this team, or maybe they've watched them once or whatever. And they're kind of basing their entire view of a team based off, you know, one game they saw or like a highlight package they saw, or you know, just off the stat sheet or whatever. You said you reach out to all these people, so it seems like do you find value in going beyond your just trusting yourself, but also, you know, finding other ways to assess a team?
Yeah, definitely huge to like really get a coach's opinion. And it, initially, I have to try to get them out of like coach cliche speech,
yes,
because they're trying to say, you know, like,
oh, yeah,
well, everybody just gives so much effort. And, you know, she's our verbal leader, but she also does it with her actions. And I'm like, please, I'm about to jump off a cliff. Don't go there. Like, trying to dig information, like, okay, who steps up when you guys are really in bad times? Like, trying to figuring out like the right questions to ask is something that I'm still kind of learning and trying to figure out. But that's the best way for me, because people want to have like frank conversations. And anyone who's coaching right now in sports, or anyone who wants to have discussions like we're having, they pay attention to those details and they care about those details. So they want to tell other people about them. And I think that's like the best thing. You can always glean information about, okay, what does this coach actually also think about Washington State? So like, you're trying to get to know their team, but you're also trying to get to know obviously the team, the other team as well. Like, it's such a two-way street, and it's, you kill two birds with one stone by talking to just one coach. And the other thing I also do is I watch a lot of detail on ESPN Plus, because I love seeing like how NBA players see certain things and like those details, and trying to like remember those and see them in games. Because I think honestly, a lot of people, like color analyst wise, and I've had games like this too, where you don't see things in the moment because you're thinking about other things, and you almost have like a script played in your head how you think the game should go and how you think it's going to go, and like your four keys to the game or three keys to the game, whatever. And you're focused on those so much that you're not realizing the actual story of the game. So like remembering that the story tells, or the game tells the story, you don't, that is what I try to focus on. And I'm like, I know I need to keep focusing on that, you know, never get too excited about how well you're doing or, you know, any compliments you get. Like, it's definitely still always going to be about preparing and like seeing how the game grows. You have to grow with it.
That's great. And we've had you for a long time. If you wouldn't mind sticking around for a little bit longer to talk about the men's hoops, that'd be okay?
Yeah, of course.
Cool. Let's take a quick break, and then we'll come back. And I'd love to hear Alyssa's thoughts on the men's hoops team this year. So taking a break. And we're back.
I almost beat you to it.
I've stolen it from you over these 117 episodes. It used to be mine now.
I don't like this. We had a routine, Craig, for like 115 episodes. Well, we had a routine
I could have grabbed the bumper music. I didn't do the bumper music.
That is true.
Too locked into the combo.
We're kind of like an old married couple at this point.
Yeah.
It's very cute to see you guys work through arguments.
Oh.
So
it's just the same,
cute, Craig.
The same arguments over and over and over again.
Just like a married couple.
Just like a married couple, yep.
Exactly. So that's why we have to bring guests on, because our listeners are sick of it. But yeah, listen, I know when I was messaging with you about this, you definitely mentioned the men's team too. And I just love you as an outsider, a bit, obviously someone who has covered WSU for years. Although, you know, covering the enemy, in Jeff and I's opinion right now,
we won't talk too much
about that.
We hope your next month isn't too fun. You can have a little bit of fun. We just don't want it to be too much fun, especially around April 5th.
Fun.
That's my birthday. I don't want that to be too much fun for you. They're obviously, Alyssa works at Gonzaga. So if anyone's not figured that out. So she's not perfect. All right, everyone. But I would love to get, you're smart basketball mind. I don't know how much you watched the men's team this year, but what are your thoughts on what Kyle Smith has got going?
Well, early on, I watched more early on than I did later on. But I think what I was most curious to see, obviously, is how they made up for CJ Elby being gone, not just scoring, but assists. And I think Isaac Bonton was the natural to step into that, but I wanted to see a little bit more progression just field goal efficiency wise with him, like choices that he was making in game. But I understand that he also had young guys around him. Like, they were so young, especially around him, like guard position wise. I know they really want to improve, you know, ball handling. They have to, because turnover wise, I think they were in negative two around there, like turnover margin. That's not going to win you games in, you know, a tight Pac-12, because there's no crazy leader in that conference. But I wanted to see a little bit more progression with him, just shooting wise and just like what he was taking, because his other guys stepped up. Like Yakimovsky was a fun, he was so much fun to watch early on in the season. I think he had, it might've been Oregon State early on when he had a great game, like just so many freshmen stepping up, and DeSean Jackson, and like their rebounding was also really impressive from that, the youth point, like the way that they care about that so much. You can tell Kyle Smith is making a huge emphasis as he goes forward, continuing to bring in big guys. And I think I talked to him over the summer. They were pumped about this freshman team, the freshman guys coming in. But obviously, you want to give respect to the guys that were still there. And I think it just, like, gel-wise, the off-season, not having an off-season to really fully implement those freshmen hurt them mid-season to late season, because they had the excitement early on. They were unscouted. But when you actually need to win games, you need to rely on some set offense and some, you know, chemistry that is only developed with repetition. And I think that that didn't really pan out in their favor at the end of the season.
And from your perspective, how valuable are those reps as a freshman? You know, they, and truly, like, they're all going to be freshmen again next year, so who knows how long they stick around, but they're technically freshmen. But just to, we had so many freshmen, so many sophomores get so many reps. Do you think just naturally that, you know, from your perspective, does that allow them to improve faster, or is it, can you dive in too quickly, or, you know, how do you see that?
I think it makes a huge difference for a big time on the men's side, because you have guys that are already there that are already, they've already established themselves. And like, how does Isaac Bonton play? How do, you know, other guys distribute the ball? Like, just getting more reps around those guys and seeing how they play, you have to kind of figure out your role within that. But they're also, with all the time that they all got, they're getting chemistry with each other. They're getting repetitions and like learning about each other at the new pace, right? So like, college from high school is a different, completely different pace. And you're expected to do a lot more. You're going against defenses that actually care about defense, because in high school and AAU, defense is basically a joke. I mean, you're in passing lanes and stuff like that, but you don't have to follow a scouting report and plan like that. So from the on-court perspective, it's super helpful just physically seeing and playing with other people's patterns. But the off-the-court, like preparing for games, scouting, like knowing that, especially on Kyle Smith's team, you're not going to play if you don't carry out what the scouting report says, like what they want to do defensively, who they want to play. So I think they will all have a way better idea of that after this first season, for sure.
Yeah, you saw that with Kyle's. We'd sort of see players that would play a few minutes early in the game and then not play at all the rest of the game. And, you know, he'll come out in the post game and say, you know, he gave up too many points on defense. That's usually what it was. You know, he just wasn't executing on defense. Because they have a lot, you know. I will say, you mentioned Bonton. He definitely turned it around. he was a blast to watch for, and Jeff wrote a nice piece on it. He was probably one of the, for a nice 5-game stretch, probably one of the top 5 players in the league. You know, like you said, just being more efficient with his shots, taking better shots, finishing shots. Like he was just, you know, if you watch him earlier in the season, he was just missing layups and missing open threes and just, you know, missing shots that he shouldn't be missing. Yeah, he definitely turned it around. I believe me, we were all thinking the same thing at the start of the season.
Well, that's good to know too, because like, there's no way I wanted to pay attention and like watch all the things as much as I could, but it's so like selective sometimes when you're like following different teams, and he's such an athlete. He's so crafty and able, mm-hmm. like I also remember him as hitting so many freaking half court shots, like as like our halftime winds down, first half winds down, he's always like bombing the half court shot. I feel like he hit like three of those last year. So incredibly exciting player. But I'm curious, like outside of him, for you guys, who are you most excited about with like those freshmen?
Oh, let us, I mean, do we have to pick one? Like I have three children. That's like asking me to pick my favorite son.
I told you that we just spent 2 hours talking to John Anderschek.
That's
about
right.
All these, and a lot of it was on the freshman. But yeah, so if I'm going to go with one, I mean, long term, I mean, honestly, the most exciting player in terms of a ceiling is F.A.
Right.
Just because of his athleticism. But if F.A. even approaches that ceiling next year, he's gone. So. Yes. So we thought early in the season, like, this might be the only year we have of him. That could still be a possibility. Who knows? You never know how the draft, like, we didn't think CJ was going to leave last year either. So, you never know what the draft process is going to look like. But honestly, DeSean Jackson WSU has never had a post big like that, just a traditional post big, be that good as a freshman. And as we talked with John, he missed so much time to start the season. He didn't practice for months leading into the season, missed first few games. So, as a 6'10" guy, the big guys like him, they usually get back even slower than the guards. But
yeah,
once the middle of Pac-12 play hit, he was one of our best players. And he is so good at using his size to get in the paint and make the most awkward looking shots you've ever seen, just probably getting hacked all the way, but you know, he's just so big they don't call it. He showed off, like, I would guess, like, he had an incredibly high shooting percentage on his like 15-foot jumpers because he didn't take very many, but he seemed to hit every single one of them. So he definitely has that in his game. He draws fouls, like, he gets to the free throw line. His free throw shooting got better as the season progressed. He's a very good defensive player, made one of the most incredible blocks of the season to save a game in regulation against ASU. Very athletic and big and strong. And I think he's a guy that by the time he's a junior, senior, is going to be one of the, you know, honestly, like, most dominant big men in the conference. And that's really exciting.
I would say mine is TJ Bamba. That's my guy. So partway through the year, I don't know, man, I just watch his, the way that he moves. He's an explosive athlete, a little out of control. He basically, really, he looked like a freshman is supposed to look. Like he was what we are used to in freshmen, really inconsistent. You know, flashes of, wow, that could be awesome. Also flashes of, oh my God, what are you doing? He had this he had this stretch where I swear he had one or two travel turnovers a game where he's, you know, catching the ball at the 3-point line and shuffling his feet before he puts the ball on the floor. Right. And so, and you're just like, he was trying to move too fast, pretty often. And for a guy who already has, you know, such good athleticism, he doesn't really need to do that. And then he also would, you know, pick up either that, or he'd also pick up a charge, or maybe both. Like, he just, you know, just again, the game didn't really slow down for him this year, but you could see like flashes of what he was able to do. You know, he's got a solid 3-point shot. You know, he can get to the rim. He's physical. He's got you know, really just explosive athleticism, good size, solid ball handler. Like, I'm like, that to me, that's a guy who, between, you know, and we always, Craig and I always talk about how, statistically, the biggest jump for players, with their offensive game is between their freshman and sophomore year. Like, that's always kind of the biggest jump. And he seems to me to be a prime candidate for a guy who's like all of a sudden going to take this big jump because the game's going to slow down. The turnovers are going to, you know, maybe not necessarily stop, but, you know, get, you know, pretty significantly reduced. He's already got something that so many of the other guys on the team struggle with, which is an ability to finish around the rim. So he's got that in his game already. He's really crafty once he gets there. I just think he strikes me as the kind of guy, if he sticks around, could be, you know, a high volume, high point scorer. A guy who, you know, takes 25 to 30% of the shots, scores, you know, 22 points a game. Like I think that is definitely within his reach. So, you know, I mean, I know, like, I love all the other guys too. Like I said, you know, I love Deshaun for all the reasons Craig said. I love F.A. for the reasons that he said.
Andre, of course, is super exciting
with his ability to shoot. Again, you know, similar kind of deal for him on the two pointers. You know, the game's got to slow down a little bit and he's got to have an idea of what he's doing once he gets into the lane. But, you know, I think Bamba is a guy who, you know, he was one of the, you know, lesser rated recruits in the class. So he was just kind of a, you know, your run of the mill 3-star kid and, not a lot of fanfare. Certainly not as much as, you know, some of the other guys, you know, Andre and Deshaun and, even Carlos Rosario, right? Who was considered a 4-star kid. You know, I just think he's got so much raw talent to work with. And if he's as determined as he seems, I think he's a guy who could, you know, really become a lead scorer over the next couple of years. So that's a guy who excites me. So there you go.
And the crazy thing, there's Jefferson Koulibaly, who's injured all season, and
yep,
staff is about as high on yes, him as anyone on the class.
Yep.
So yep, we could we were talking about this. We haven't seen and I'm sure you covering for as long as you've covered the team for the last I'm guessing 6 years or so. This is the most stacked roster they've had in a long time. And it's,
yeah.
And it just have, it, how much did you, you know, while you were still at KXLY and everything and doing that role, did you get to interact with Coach Smith much? Did you get an impression of him at all?
Yeah. I was there for his introductory presser and the touted nerd ball, like fit to form. It was perfect. Like you could just see this guy, he cares so much. And like he was nerdy and it was perfect. I absolutely loved it. And what excites me is like what he's going to do with this talent. Like that's mm-hmm. the development is going to be so exciting. And if he has guys that not only have that instinct and have that, I mean, obviously F.A. Agabi, like I clearly has the raw athleticism, but guys like TJ and, you know, Andre and like they have that IQ and the instinct already. So like how they have to be interested in watching film and watching, like knowing their analytics stuff. Like there's no one better than Kyle Smith, I feel like, in the college basketball realm to get those guys even better. So like the development is what super excites me. And you could tell that he cared about that when he got in. And it was basically a question of like, how are you going to get great players to Pullman? Not just because it's, you know, it's a tough place to get to, but it's because they hadn't had success under Ken Bone. And it had been a while. The last, you know, it was really Bennett that those mm-hmm. were the best years since, you know, for a long time before that. So it was like, how can he get the guys? Will he be able to get the guys? Because his personality is fun and it's lighthearted, but he doesn't have that like swanky charm that other, you know, mm-hmm. college coaches might have. And I think I'm just so pumped to see the development of like his true most impressive freshman class. It's going to be fun to watch.
It strikes me that there's a couple of things that really are important when recruiting. You know, number one, you have to have a really clear sense of who you're looking for, what kind of player you're looking for. And I think that's a thing that I noticed that Kyle Smith has. He has a very clear sense of the guys that are going to work for him. It was funny. I did an interview with him right after he got hired and he talked about his 6 tool players that they're looking for. We want guys who can dribble and shoot and pass. And, you know, I don't even remember what all 6 of them are. And I'm like, that's amazingly vague. You know, I'm like, don't you want, like, isn't everybody looking for guys who can do all of those things?
Dribble
like,
and pass.
Like, if they can do all those things, aren't they 5-star recruits? Like, I don't.
We all want a LeBron James, please.
Just right. You know, it's like those kids are not coming to Wazoo. But as I've watched the last 2 years, again, this was before I had ever watched a game that he had coached, and even in that first year last year, it became really obvious to me what he was talking about. Like, all of a sudden I was like, oh, okay, I get it, right? Like he's not looking for guys who are, you know, necessarily, I mean, obviously he would love to have guys who are really good at all six of those things, but there's like kind of a baseline level, and he wants to get guys who are as good as they can be with at least like maybe four or five of those things. Six is great, but like if we can get to four or five and they've got a certain kind of baseline level of skill, they'll work with what we are trying to do. And it was sort of really obvious in that first year with some of the guys that Ernie had left behind, that Lev's like, oh yeah, now I see why, you know, a guy like, you know, Marvin Cannon doesn't really fit, right? Cause he kind of a little bit of a one trick pony, like really good at that one trick, but kind of like that's all he can do. And so he's kind of lost, you know, and there were a couple guys that just kind of got lost cause they had one really good skill and that just kind of doesn't work with Kyle Smith. So he has a good sense of the kind of guy he's trying to get. And then, they just hustle. There's hustle. And, you know, we had John, you know, we were talking about this. We had John Andershek on, you know, a couple days ago. You know, and that's, he's sort of a prime example of a guy who just hustles. You know, he's up at all hours of the night, you know, texting kids, messaging kids. I mean, heck, I think his first contact with FA was a Facebook message, you know, just like a random one-off, like, hey, how's it going? You know, it's like, it's crazy. And I think that those two skills are, you know, and then of course the ability to implement it once they get on campus,
but the talent level, you know. Yeah. Like something that John did what he told us he did on the last podcast is when he was bored during the shutdown, he decided to break down and analyze every single defensive possession from the previous season. So
what?
You're talking like 2,100.
Not just analyze them, but he broke, but he clipped them all. He pulled all the clips.
2,000 possessions, like, is what you're talking about.
And so
he's the type of guy that Smith has on his staff, and Smith is like, obviously they just, yeah, like Jeffy said, like it just, sorry, I cut you off, but I had to,
no, it's just. That's it. You know, so you do those two things and then have a clear sense also of the talent level you need to be successful. And, you know, Kyle, I think also has a very clear sense of what it's going to take to, you know, which guys are going to actually be able to help him be competitive, help the team be competitive in the Pac-12. And that's what gets, you know, that's what gets me excited. It's the wins. Yes. It's the, you know, the progress that they've made. Yes. It's the recruiting class that's really the best that they've had in a while by recruiting services. Yes. I mean, all that stuff's great, but it's just sort of like, you know, you mentioned Tony Bennett. The parallels are really there. You know, Tony's best asset for all of the plaudits that he gets. I will say carry to my grave that his absolute 100% best asset is his ability to identify talent and his ability to look at a guy and be like, that guy is not only just going to work with me, but he could be a really good basketball player. And you look at, you know, I mean, this is a guy who recruited Aaron Baines. Well, Aaron Baines is in the NBA. It's a guy who recruited Klay Thompson when nobody else was recruiting Klay Thompson. Klay Thompson's a Hall of Famer. This is a guy who recruited Kyle Weaver when really nobody else wanted him. Well, Kyle Weaver had a cup of coffee in the NBA and had a nice career in Europe. Well, you know, Derek Lowe had a great career
he was going to bring Joe Harris to Pullman and then a kid from Chelan.
Took him to Virginia. Yeah
Joe Harris is in the NBA.
And he's a very good NBA player.
Yep.
So that's to me, that's Tony's strength. And I think that needs to be the strength of any coach who's not coaching at, you know, Kentucky, Duke, North Carolina or whatever, is like, you got to be able to look at a kid and see not only what he is, but what he can be for you. and that's Tony's strength. And I see that same kind of strength in Kyle and John and, you know, and the other coaches there. You know, I think they have that same strength, and that's the part that gives me, you know, just so much optimism for where we're going.
Yeah. I could not agree more on Tony, and just like they care about the player, but they care about the smarts of the player, not just raw athleticism. And just like potential is one thing when it is athleticism, but potential with your brain and like everything above the shoulders, that's what's way more important if you're in a late game situation, because you can still, if your athleticism is going to meet athleticism at the end of a game, you know, it's about who's going to take a good shot, who's going to take a smart shot or distribute. And the potential for IQ and that brain and like how much they can improve there is huge for a place like Pullman.
Yeah. And I think nothing like shows how the care he has for the players, like is WSU had three players enter the transfer portal today. And two were Miles Warren and Brandon Chatfield. They're both non-scholarship players. They're both players that definitely could get scholarships at some level of college basketball. I think Miles Warren at probably a mid-major, you know, low-major type school could definitely contribute. You know, Brandon Chatfield could definitely get a scholarship somewhere, be a D2 or, you know, low-major as well. But one thing that jumps out to me is Jazz Kuntz in the transfer portal. And we know he almost did last year too. And then he decided to come back, but he had, you know, a great turnaround at the end of the season. You see some coaches when players leave, they're very petty about it. But towards the end of the season, Kyle Smith said nothing but good things about Jazz, and they had to have known this was something that could have been a possibility. And then we just had the day before Jazz enters the portal, we have, John Anderschek on here, and he spends 5 minutes saying just effusively praising Jazz Kuntz for all that he does, all that he contributed to the team. He says, you know, one of the best, like, you know, allowed some of the fewest points as a defender. Works his butt off, is a great leader, all this stuff. He became a great rebounder by the end of the season. Like, it just, he obviously started hitting shots and that helped, but too. But they care about these players. They want them to go continue to succeed somewhere else, even if it's not in Pullman. And maybe they have another recruit lined up and they want to bring him in. And so it's beneficial to them too, but they don't have to. They don't have to sell this player to other programs, but they do. And, you know, Kyle Smith, Jeff, you mentioned after the Stanford game, that he just praised Kuntz. He had a nice game that game and, praised him and all this stuff. And so it's cool to have, you know, you can just kind of feel the care that the staff has for the players when even the outgoing players who they don't, they have these players and they have these like nice, like Miles Warren is probably about as good as like a non-scholarship player as you can get on a Pac-12 school. Like it's like, and so they had every reason to be like, stay around, you know, you're nice, like emergency guard to have, like, but he said, hey, go find a scholarship somewhere. Because being a walk-on is not the best deal in the world. So that's something that I wanted to bring up because obviously that's news today. We had to talk about it. But, I think it – I don't know if you ever felt that, you know, as a player, do you having a coach that kind of cares about you, cares about more than just, you know, your points and rebounds, how important is that?
It absolutely matters. And I think I'm fine with saying it might matter more with women than with men because the chemistry is huge and how much you trust someone kind of determines like how much you'll go to bat for them. And I think I'd be really curious, and I'm sure they handled it exactly like you're talking with the team too, like the players that are still there. How is Coach Smith talking about the guys that are leaving the program? How does he announce it to them? Because that will totally impact how much more they might respect him as well. if he's just trashing on these guys or not even giving them the time of day, hey, they're out of the program, we move on. We survive in advance. We keep moving forward. Only the strong survive. Like some stuff like that. Like if you give that kind of vibe to your players, it's like, okay, well, am I dispensable too? If I were to choose something different, you promised me that you kind of would care for me and kind of be like a kind of a dad, you know, when you're moving away from home and being in a different place. You expect to have a little bit of leadership and rely on this team as your family. So it absolutely matters how they handle those kind of situations. And it says a lot about who they are as people, because obviously you don't want people to leave the program, but not everything works out the way it's supposed to, especially 18-year-olds making decisions, which is why I'm a big fan of the one-time transfer, you know, at least once. It gets a little crazy when it's constant freebie everywhere, but like you, it's really hard to make a great decision as an 18 or 19 year old.
Of course.
And a perfect decision. It's way more rare than it is normal to make a great decision. So I think it absolutely impacts it. And it gives you a chance as a coach to gain more respect for who you are, backing up your actions with the words that you kind of use to recruit them.
Yeah, and of course, Jazz is a guy that came in under Ernie Kent, so this is not the coach that he signed up for.
Right.
So being able to transfer is a big deal because I'm sure that you committed to Newley as much as you committed to Idaho, right?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And who he was as a person, he's the person I talk about constantly now too, that believed in me before I ever did. Like I became so much of a better leader after that program and just like how I live my life, like decisions I make now. Yeah, it was tough, but I knew I could tell going in, he was going to be kind of a hard guy and just not always sunshine and rainbows. He was going to tell it to me straight, which I hadn't had yet. Mm-hmm. And it sucked when I was in those situations and I made big mistakes, but it wasn't like, he didn't forgive, and he made it clear, like, I give second chances. I know that 18 to 22 years old, 23 years old is not an easy time. We want to be there for you in any way we can. And the coaching staff too, the assistants, one assistant is still there and she's one of my best friends now. So, I think it's rare, but it's so nice when you do kind of make the decision based on what feels right and what kind of feels like home when you're getting recruited for sure.
Yeah. And that's huge for Pullman, the home, the family vibe, everything, obviously.
Yeah.
And Idaho too, obviously it's, you know, we're in the same spot. I'm curious, Jeff, are you there or?
I'm still here, man.
Okay. I just haven't seen
it. I'm just listening. Like
I haven't seen
like, this is good stuff.
I hadn't seen the little spindle thing spin for us yet for a while. So I was like, you are being incredibly quiet. So that was impressive. But
it's unusual. I know it's unusual, but you know, I'm just listening, man. It's good stuff.
I do got to know, it. Alyssa, what were your favorite Palouse like breakfast spots, lunch spots, all that stuff?
Oh, great question. Well, of course, I'm going to give you the one that you didn't ask, and it's dinner, and it's Casa Lopez.
Of course.
For sure.
Yes. The bean dip.
Oh, my gosh. Yes. Wow. I got way too excited about that now. I just like sucked in way too much air. I miss it. Oh, the carne asada, the bean dip. So, so good. Sangria, obviously, pretty incredible. Over in Pullman, I loved Black Cypress.
Nice, yeah. Good spot.
I didn't, in terms of brunch, okay, the old European, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Is that still around? Is that still there?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
To be honest, that though, like, I lived over in Moscow, the Breakfast Club, man. That's still there, too. That place is good.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I needed to throw in a few Pullman restaurants because I didn't go there a ton, but I know that they had great. I mean, the Palouse is so underrated for food. I think we have such good restaurants. And Breakfast Club zucchini, was it zucchini huckleberry zucchini bread? Did
oh
you have
yes,
that?
Yep, yep.
Whoa,
yeah, that stuff's good.
Yeah,
gotta love huckleberries, man. People just don't. I moved to the East Coast, and no one knew what a huckleberry was. It's hilarious.
yes.
Yeah,
What is wrong with those people?
Well, they don't have them out there, and you can't grow them. You can't grow them commercially. You have to fight bears for them. There is no other way.
You have to go up in the mountains and find some on your own, and
like you got to be in Montana, Idaho, Washington, Oregon, basically to get huckleberries.
Yeah, we did go up, not last summer, but the summer before. Maybe it was last summer. We went up into Mount Rainier National Park and got some fresh, wild huckleberries. And there was also a bear helping himself over in a field.
Wow.
About 100 yards, 120 yards away. And
that was too close.
And yeah, it was, and I'm like, we should be moving on now. And Sarah's like, oh no, this is great. And I'm like, no, we should really be moving on. She's like, but isn't this cool? The bear's right there. I'm like, yes, the bear is right there.
Pretty sure
we should be moving on.
Pretty sure that's inside the recommended distance. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, but it's up there. It's, the bears are, I guess, kind of used to the humans. And as long as you're not disturbing their berry foraging, then I think they're pretty much okay with you. We even had one time we were up there, a bear, like literally, now this is kind of in one of the busier parts near, Paradise, but the bear actually was up on a hillside, ran down the hill, and everybody's kind of watching it going, wait a second, where's that bear going? It's coming right at us. It ran right down the hill and right across the hiking path. And then right down the hill and out of sight and like literally within 10 yards of 20 people who were standing around watching this bear on the hillside, the bear just decided to start running at the people, ran right past them and ran down the hill the other side. And it was like, okay, that was a little freaky.
Yeah. It's like a very dangerous situation.
Yeah.
Whoa.
It turned out apparently he or she was interested in other things, but and all these people were kind of getting close to where the bear was. And I was like, you people are nuts. I'm standing here because if I stand here, there's like 30 of you between me and that bear. And if that bear decides to get upset, I got, it's the old joke, right? You don't have to be the fastest person. You just have to be faster than the other guy. Right.
Yep.
Like, if the bear's coming, and that was my philosophy the whole time. So,
oh my gosh. You got to live. You be the one to live to tell the story.
That is exactly it. That is exactly
right.
I have to say, Alyssa, did you ever play volleyball or be asked to play volleyball because of your height?
I love the follow-up question. I played by my own choice in junior high and high school, and it didn't work. It was such a fun sport. So, so, so much fun. But I had a teammate try to play both in college, and it was a max. It was just a train wreck every single day. So I was like, I'm really glad that I did not try to go that route.
Well, that was my classic segue we got to give the WC volleyball team some credit, some shout out.
Oh yeah.
They are currently in first place and they are playing UW this weekend for a home and away series with first place on the line. UW is in second by percentage points. So pretty exciting time. You can catch, if you're listening, you can catch those games. I'm not sure what they're on. At the very least, they're going to be on the WSU live stream and UW live stream. But you might be able to catch them on Pac-12. I haven't looked yet, but, volleyball is such a fun.
I've seen a few.
Yeah.
I've seen a few on Pac-12 Network.
Yeah. Yeah.
For Wazoo.
Oh yeah. So I just looked, they're both the one on Friday is on Pac-12 Washington. I would assume the one on Sunday is as well. They usually put I think one of the games you did for basketball was the WSU UW game. I think that might be the one that we saw, but because they always put the rivalry games on TV. So,
Yes.
Pac-12 Washington, check it out. Huge game, super young, fun team to watch. I've said it before. They are, Jen Greeny's on this, unfortunate kind of scholarship, rotation where she always has a year where she loses six seniors and has to fill them with six, scholarships. So she loses half her team, all her leaders, whatever. But she has done that and they've just kept it rolling. They would have made the tournament last year, and they look like they're in line to do that again this year. So that just a hell of a program, one of the better ones that, you know, WC's ever had. And so just got to give them a shout out. Because I at this point, Alyssa, you're riding with us till the end. You lasted this long.
I'm in.
Yeah, you're stuck.
It's funny. I asked her, like, what do you think about tags? But she's like, well, I like to be really thorough. 30 to 45 minutes. I'm like, well,
yeah, you're not very That's familiar not thorough. With how long our podcast normally lasts because we talk.
Well,
so
I know.
Much, but...
A level up. Goodness, yeah. I love it. You guys have changed the standard. Talk about changing standards. Wrap it up from the beginning of it. Like, Cam Yether just changed the standard, so are you guys. We are thorough and we are in depth. I think now I'm beyond a special guest. Like, count me in as like third player off the bench for the podcast.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, well, this podcast would definitely improve by at least 150%.
As long as you don't get too famous, because I'm worried about this. You're always welcome, and this has been great. But I do. Are you going to Texas for the tournament? Do you get to go down there? Or is this virtual stuff?
I don't think so. There was like really quick talk about the possibility. I'm not completely closing out hope because since they did have me as like the on-site field reporter and in studio person, they're comfortable with me doing that, but it would have to be like maybe a Final Four national champion situation for Pac-12 networks, and obviously they wouldn't have the game or anything. But I'm not totally, you know, crushing my own dreams, but I do need to be realistic, and it's probably not going to happen.
And what was it like, that experience of standing for 8 hours a day on the sideline in Las Vegas for the Pac-12 tournament?
Comfortable shoes were very necessary. I love, like, the coaches are super casual this year. I was wearing Nikes and I was wearing like Hoka running shoes. I was nursing shoes. Like, I was not messing around, and it was so fun to be that close, but I was not top fashionable.
Jessamyn McIntyre always joked about how when she covered the football team, that after one game of trying to keep up with Mike Leach on his way into the locker room, that she had to get some better shoes, because there was no way she was gonna. I think she wore some variation of, I don't think it was heels, but it was like dress shoes of some variety. And she realized after one game that was not going to do it. And that shoes. And by the way, as a teacher, I can appreciate how important it is to have good shoes, because it, like, everything starts with your feet, man. It all starts with your feet. And if your feet are messed up, everything else is messed up. So, yeah, you got to wear those comfy shoes.
Well, so true. And Mike Leach being sneaky fast.
Yeah.
I mean, that all needs to be said.
Yes.
It's kind of deceptive.
Yep. And deceptive speed.
I, of course, and this is called preparation in the biz, but I was stalking you on Instagram. And I saw your post from when you were with, you know, when you were covering the team for KXLY, when you were in a boot yourself, and Mike Leach commented on it, right?
Yeah, it was so good. I had the boot on, and he, like, honestly, it was probably my fourth encounter with him where he had already seen my boot, but maybe he was like plotting it out in his head a little bit about what to say, or he just straight up didn't recognize it until that point. But he was asking me what the injury was, and I was like, oh, it's a stress fracture. And shoot, now I forget the punchline to it. It's like, oh, you should probably relax more.
like
it took me like
that's
3 seconds, and I was
Mike
like,
Leach
oh.
joke. That is a very, very...
Right? And he had like the side smile, like the tiniest smile, like, just wait till you get it. You're going to be impressed.
Yeah, 100%. He's like dad joke central, that guy. And I'm sure, by the way, he wasn't really setting it up. The guy, I swear, is like ADHD. Like, he just is like, you know, da 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 da. And then all of a sudden something catches eye, and he's like, oh, shiny thing. Look at that. You know? Like, now I'm curious about this. I mean, I did a thing where I got to go. It was very cool. I got to go sit in on a quarterbacks meeting with him and some of the guys. Nice. This was spring football a couple of years ago. And, you know, it was, I don't know if you remember, but Pullman had like this biblical rain that like flooded downtown. This was like spring football, I think 2 years ago. And, I'm attending this thing the next day. The flood had come the night before, and like, you know, I'm just sort of hanging out in there, and I'm trying to be, you know, real quiet because I don't want to, you know, upset anything. And he's like, yeah, did you hear about that flood? And I'm like, yeah, did you see the pictures? And all of a sudden he's like, oh, and he's taking my phone. And I'm like, you know, kind of, and he's like looking at pictures. And I'm thinking is, I didn't send any text messages to anybody that is going to like,
oh my gosh,
respond to it. Like notifications aren't going to pop up on my screen right now. Right. Like, and I'm like racking my brain. I'm like, I didn't leave like a weird, like website open. Like I'm just thinking like Mike Leach has like my phone and if something weird pops up. So anyway, yeah, crisis averted, everything turned out okay.
If I send you some Hangouts messages, like talking crap about Leach, you know, like,
yeah, yeah. You're like, because I was texting my friends, you know, I'm like, hey, I'm in this quarterback's meeting. This is so cool. And da da da. And like, yeah. I could just imagine somebody texting back, like, is Mike Leach being weird? You know, pop up. I don't know. So anyway, I was thankful once he handed the phone back to me and I felt like we connected for a sec over, you know, flood photos, downtown. So anyway.
Oh yeah. And it's always the most random things for a connection.
Totally.
Like that.
The most
but it's the best. You will never forget it. Like he is such a memorable character in literally every way.
No doubt. No doubt. And he's like the guy that people see in the press conferences where people were like, you know, is like, that can't be real. Right. And I'm like, no,
yeah,
for real. Like, that's it. Like this is
genuine.
This is him. Like, this is not an act. It's not a shtick. I mean, I think he leans into it. So, I mean, I think
there's
a bit of that, but no, but like, this is pretty much who he is.
Yeah.
And this is pretty much what he does. And, super curious, asks a ton of questions and will engage with anyone. So.
Yes. Will expand so far on the most random topics outside of football. And he's so passionate about it, which I can respect a ton. You have to respect it.
Yep.
He is a natural curious being.
No doubt.
Yeah. I guess I do. There was one more thing I had to mention from Instagram, and I was hoping you were going to pull it up with like what inspires you as a broadcaster. You probably might know what I'm talking about at this point. Because it drew me to the picture was you were in Beasley Coliseum and you were with Greg Heister and all that. And well, I could ask you questions about Greg because he's a pretty interesting character himself, but we're already pretty deep into this. We'll bring you back for that. How does the security guard that beat Michael Jordan at dice, how does he inspire you?
His just disposition, the quiet confidence, but you're willing to do that pose on Michael Jordan, the king of kings. Like, what? I love that. He was like maybe my favorite character from that whole thing.
Yeah, that might have been the best part of the whole series.
Right? It was like, and Michael was pissed. Like, Jordan was not happy about it. He was like joking around a little bit, but you could tell he was like pretty livid. And this dude is just coming in here and taking trophies, taking names and coins.
He's just loving it.
Yeah, you saw like...
I would take that demeanor into my everyday life for sure.
You saw the real, like the realest of real Michael Jordan at that moment. When he's losing a game, like anything, he can't lose anything. He's losing a game, any game ever. To a security guard, and he's got to wear that, and someone's got a camera on him,
and he's got to pay up. That's the other thing Mike Jordan doesn't like.
That's so true. Not a secret there, but yeah, no. I would say his inspiration of just like if a big moment happens for you, you know, just embrace it. Like hands up, like here it is. I'm gonna take it, and I don't know if I'll ever have the chance to beat Michael Jordan in anything, but. I think just with this year and how crazy it was, the opportunities come and they're fun and you gotta embrace it and be excited about it, make the most out of it. I don't know if that dude made anything with his, I'd love to know what he did with his winnings from that competition. Change the world.
Well, Alyssa, we really appreciate you coming on. This has been a blast. You open invitation anytime you want. We're always, trying to cut down the amount of times we bicker as a married couple. And it's always good to have that mediator to help mediate arguments and everything. I love the way you think about basketball. I love the way you analyze games. Yeah, we really appreciate you coming on. We're hoping, as Jeff said, women's games, men's games, hopefully when you get to travel again, you'll get to go to all sorts of places and we'll just get, you'll become a fixture and that's truly what we're hoping. So, is there anything you want to plug while you're here? You want your Twitter, your Instagram, your LinkedIn profile, anything like that?
LinkedIn for sure. I've made the joke too many times, but I'm like, yeah, check out my MySpace. I don't even know if that's a website anymore, is it? Don't look if it is.
It's a music website. It's like an MP3
website. It
really
technically exists.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. I was just randomly talking to someone, not to go on a tangent, but like how we were basically coders. Like we were making ways to like make your profile move and like stars fall down and like soundtrack of your life on your MySpace.
Oh man, I'm just thinking about your age, and yeah, you must have been in like middle school when MySpace was really, really hitting.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would have been a perfect.
Really getting after it.
Yeah, you were just learning to code, you know? STEM education, MySpace.
Yeah, exactly. So impressive. But I mean, handle wise, it's just at Alyssa Charlston. If you want the content, it is a little Gonzaga heavy, but you know,
we definitely have some Gonzaga fans. There are definitely some Cougs.
There's some crossover. Yeah. There's some cross. Not with these two guys, but there are,
right.
There's crossover.
Well, I'm excited to see what Kyle Smith keeps doing, and I want that to be a rivalry renewed.
Yes,
we'll see if it ever happens.
Put in a phone call to Mark and be like, hey man, WSU would love to play you. You know, if you're interested, you know, maybe you could be our middleman, like our broker.
There you go.
On that.
Okay. I'll try to get into the scheduling side of things.
We're putting that on you. Okay.
So. Yeah. This is your job. You want to come back on the show? Don't come back until you got us a game with Gonzaga. All right,
and not in the spoken.
Make that happen.
All right.
Yeah.
Done. I'll see you in 15 years.
No joke.
Kidding.
But seriously though, it was so cool to have you on.
Gonzaga content. I cut you off.
For what? Oh,
you said your Gonzaga content. Yeah.
I was going to make a, like, Mark Few doesn't have email joke, so I was going to send an owl or something. But anyways, awful joke. What were you talking about?
So you said you were about to say where people can find your Gonzaga stuff that you're producing, and I cut you off. So where can they find that?
So my live stuff and Gonzaga stuff and basketball stuff in general, it's all at Alyssa Charlston. There's no E in Charlston. And I have a website too, but that's just Squarespace if you search that. And I'm going to try to post some of this Pac-12, the latest Pac-12 tournament stuff, just all the crazy COVID protocol and all that. So at Alyssa Charlston.
Cool.
Thank you guys for having me on. This was so fun. Like I said, I've listened to you heavily when Mike Leach was head coach. I just didn't cover the Cougs football a ton once Rolovich got there. So just because of the job situation.
Cool.
We appreciate you elevating our level of discourse from the usual crap that we put out. So, like, for real, we're realizing that if we have guests and if they're smarter than us, then actually our podcast is better. And that's the road we're going down right now. So we're already like, cause we went a year before we ever had a guest, something like that. And then we're looking at each other going like, I don't know, maybe we should do this guest thing more
three
often.
Straight with guests. you're joining. Ooh. You're up there in the pantheon with Ken Pomeroy. So
yes, we've had Ken Pomeroy on.
So
what?
Yeah.
How about that?
I'd right? still recommend cow. Going and checking that out. We had John Anders.
That was a good show.
John Andershek with Ken Pomeroy. It was the nerdiest thing in the world. It was great.
Wait, both of them on there?
Yeah.
At the same time.
Yeah.
Yeah, John actually brokered the thing, so that was what prompted that, and we were definitely nerding out. Like the closest Craig and I have ever gotten to Ken Pomeroy before this was We had both written for Basketball Prospectus back when they used to make a book. And so we had done some stuff in there, and Ken had done some stuff in there, and we were like, look, we were in a book with Ken Pomeroy. Our name is on the book, just like his. And that was the closest.
Jeff,
and then
I have to say, I did meet him once at the.
That's
Pac-12,
right. That's
the
right. I forgot about that.
In Las Vegas.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was the highlight of my life because he, we chatted. I was beers deep for sure. And we were chatting like at halftime. I just like went over to the media table and talked to him. I was at a work conference, and the Pac-12 tournament happened to be it. I was at a work conference in the MGM, and the Pac-12 tournament was right there. It was like incredible. I was like, this is the, I barely went to the conference, let's be honest. But so I saw, he said he was there. So I like messaged him. I was like, hey, I'd love to meet you. So I went down and, we were chatting, and then right when I left, he said, keep up the good work. And I was like,
oh,
floated like back to my seat.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
And then we had him on the podcast, which was super fun. Still, that is incredible.
One of those, I'm checking that out.
One of those evergreen tomorrow. Episodes that I think, a lot of our episodes are timely, but that one was just more about theory and everything. So it was pretty great.
And if I remember right, he claimed to remember you, which was even better. So
yes, I'm sure he actually didn't.
Is he a good liar? I'll determine. Yeah. They talk about it. You guys talk about it on the podcast, whether he remembers you or not.
I don't remember now, Jeff. Did he say that he remembered me? I think he did.
We might have, or maybe
no.
It was before we were recording.
Yeah, it might have been before.
But
okay.
Yeah. Well, okay. Craig gets the treatment. You know, I don't know. Maybe this happens to you as well because you're rather tall, right? So Craig is also rather tall. Craig is 6'5". So. Easy to remember tall people, I imagine. So, yeah.
Yeah.
One of the few pros.
Tall, drunk guy in Coug gear.
Hard to forget.
Yeah. It is true.
We wrote a book together. It's great.
I'm extremely forgettable. It's okay. So,
depends how long.
It's good to be remembered
for something. Depends on how long your beard is at that point.
That is true. The beard's not very long right now, so I'm very
forgettable.
I'm just middle aged dad right now, and that's
I'm morphing into that.
That is all there is.
I'll never forget either of you.
Thank you.
I can't wait for the next one, and I will definitely watch that one tomorrow. Or listen, watch. Yeah. Listen to that one.
Good
tomorrow.
Luck watching.
Cannot wait.
If you figure out a way to watch it, then you have hacked into our computers in some way that I don't understand.
There's a reason why we do not record. We do not record these podcasts. We do not live stream them, and we have good reason for that. Let me tell you.
Love it. We tried to do that years ago. It was not great.
Yeah,
it didn't. But
well, I'm all for it.
But if you're a big fan of the pod like Alyssa, and you haven't subscribed to it yet, please subscribe. Rate us 5 stars. Leave a good message about how we have really good guests. and then, if you got an email question for us or a comment, or if you have any ideas that you want us to talk about, because in about a month, things are going to be less busy. This is probably the busiest sports season we've ever had. With all the fall sports being played in the spring. So that's podcastvseveryone@gmail.com. I'm at the Craig Powers on Twitter. Jeff runs the @podversuseveryone account where he spouts just fire mean things about Pac-12 analysts. Unless their name is Alyssa Charlston, then it's 100% positivity.
That's pretty much the rule of thumb.
All right. Again, thanks, Alyssa. You don't have to say it's Alyssa, but Jeff and I are going to say it. We're going to say go Cougs.
Yeah, go Cougs, Craig. Black Lives Matter.
Black Lives Matter.